Hello, and thank you very much for coming along to EcoViews and News. This evening we're going to look at the problem of economic growth and our climate change circumstance. There have been a lot of attention has justifiably been paid to Bill McKibben and his nationwide tour at this point, trying to put the brakes on the use of fossil fuels in one way or another. In fact, to create an atmosphere and a movement, not only in this country, but around the world, against the increased use of fossil fuels and the continued use of fossil fuels in places like the tar sands from Canada and the like. Bill has been quite explicit about this in the past, and there are a number of people who are joining him and who have been out there in some sense in front of him, and he's deriving his own insights from their work. And one of those I want to focus on today is a foremost environmental organizer from the 1970s right on, and a person who's been in the front lines with Bill McKibben working on these problems of getting to a post-carbon fueled economy, getting beyond carbon for our fuel. Now, this is a fellow who's been quite prominent in environmental groups, in educational circles, and in international environmental movements, head of the United Nations Environment Program, for one thing, for many years in Kenya. But he was in the front lines of those who were arrested down at the White House. His name is Gus Speth, and the title today is Criminalizing the Best and the Brightest. Gus Speth on the Origins and Character of Our Climate Crisis. Well, you may be used to hearing Bill McKibben on these themes. He came through Boston not long ago as part of his nationwide tour, but it's worth, in fact, listening to his critique of the link between continued growth and the climate crisis. Here was a statement he made 5 years ago, actually, or a little less than 5 years ago,
if there was one basic idea that explains, that lies behind American policy, and really policy of most places around the world, in the last 50 or 60 years, it would be the economic idea that more is better. That's been the sort of driving force. And we can tell it's the driving force because, you know, every president, no matter of what party, and every legislature takes economic growth as the single most important thing that they can be talking about. And every policy that we pass is justified on the grounds that it will in some way aid the increase in the size of our economies and things. It's a very powerful idea, and the only problem with it is that it no longer works very well. And that's the kind of insight from which this book begins. No longer works very well in two ways. One is that it's helping us drive off an ecological cliff, and to drive off it pretty quickly. Climate change is the best example of that, but it's not the only one. I've spent a lot of time in the last couple of years in Asia reporting for National Geographic and Harper's and others, and getting to see the Chinese economy close at hand, extremely vibrant and dynamic and fascinating to watch. Economy that's growing at 10% a year. If it keeps growing like that, by the middle of the century, the Chinese will be as rich as we are on average. If they consume in the ways that we do, well, you know, there's 800 million automobiles on Earth right now. The Chinese alone would add 1.1 billion automobiles. Mm-hmm. If they ate our diet, the Chinese alone would consume two-thirds of the world's grain harvest. And that's before you get to the Indians and everybody else sort of right behind them. It's not physically possible for this endless expansion to continue.
Okay. It's not physically possible for this endless expansion to continue. Can't get a more clear statement than that about the growthism that's behind the climate crisis. It's behind the resource crises, and it's going to be increasingly behind this whole question of differential access to resources. Who's going to get access to these declining resources, and what happens when the competition sets in? Well, this has been the rationale for bills moving quite vociferously against the use of tar sands from Canada, and the tar sands action movement got going on the logic that we can't afford to use these carbon fuels because we can't survive the outcome of using them. Students got together under Bill's leadership, but a lot of students were involved and had their own leaders to stop the pipeline and demonstrate in front of the White House. You may recall their sessions. They were very impressive community organizing sessions. Take a look.
There are now more than 2,100 people who've said they're coming. This will be the largest civil disobedience protest, certainly in the history of the climate movement, and really one of the biggest things of its kind to happen in a very, very long time.
Tomorrow, we're all going to commit nonviolent direct action.
So we are here because we believe in the environment, we believe in equity and equality.
We shouldn't have to be here doing this, but tests, defining moments, just kind of sometimes appear. And this is one of those times.
So right now, the police have given you a number of warnings. The time to arrest you has come. How are we going to deal with it as a group?
I'm not here because I want to be here. I'm here because I need to be here.
Any last pressing concerns about getting arrested?
Oh my gosh, I'm scared out of my mind. That's how I'm feeling. It's just something that feels like it has to be done, so it's just not in the realm of my typical conception of what would be happening on the next day of my life.
If you are going to be risking arrest, you're going to be lining up on this sidewalk over here.
ExxonMobil made more money last quarter than any company in the history of money. We have to find a different currency to work in. And our currency today and for the next 2 weeks is our bodies and our creativity and our spirit.
This is your third and final warning. If you don't leave now, you will be arrested.
Well, you can see they were lining up, they were being prepared to be arrested, and they were arrested out in front of the White House. It was really quite an impressively organized civil disobedience, the largest one in the climate movement, and the largest one for several decades, in fact, in any movement, coming down in front of the White House. So it was really quite an impressive demonstration of public solidarity. In that video clip, and in fact in that crowd, if you were there, you would have noticed several different things, including some very eminent people in the lineup, as it were, before things started happening. Here's Bill over here himself, but if you look at who's standing next to him, you'll get an idea of why we're focusing tonight on Gus Speth. Gus Speth was at the time the former dean of the Yale School of Forestry, and he stood shoulder to shoulder with Bill on his way to being arrested, along with several other important academics. As he put it at the time, you have to draw a line in the sand somewhere. It's an interesting play on words. It wasn't the tar sands he was thinking of, but the gesture of drawing a line and saying, look here and no further. It's very interesting to hear his formulation of this. Take a look.
We have to draw a line in the sand somewhere, and this is a perfect place to draw it. It's a new, controversial, unconventional fossil resource with tremendous potential to harm the global climate. And for Obama to do something in his own power, which doesn't require Congress, that would be electrifying and send a powerful signal around this country and around the world that we can, that we are going to act. You know, power responds to a demand, and we have to let that demand be heard. And it's time to step outside the system and do some things that we haven't done before.
Well, that's pretty extraordinary. For a former head of the UNEP, United Nations Environment Program, former dean of the School of Forestry and Environmental Studies at Yale, to say it's time to step outside the system and do some things we haven't done before is fairly unconventional, you might say. I mean, it's an effect more than unconventional. It's quite a clarion call to action. As he said, it's time to step outside the system and do some things we haven't done before. Pretty extraordinary. Now, it's worth looking into his material at greater length, because he's actually left a great deal for us to study, work on, and think about. Furthermore, when he got arrested, apparently he was in the cell next to Bill McKibben at the time, and Bill, on his current tour around the country, often shows this slide, which is taken by somebody who attended the Boston session here and caught it at an angle from the audience. And he talks about Gus being arrested here and then Gus being in the cell next to him in the Washington, D.C. Prison. And he quotes Gus as saying, "I've been in a lot of important positions in this town," meaning Washington, "but none of them as important to me as this one." That's quite a courageous statement, because he has been in a lot of important positions in that town. In fact, he was the founder of the World Resources Institute, which is one of the major environmental groups, and certainly the major one focused on international affairs down in Washington, D.C. Then he was appointed by Carter, previously he had been appointed by Carter to be head of the Council on Environmental Quality. He's been in a lot of important positions. That's an understatement in this case. So it's worth listening to what he has to say. And you can get access to it. He's not shy. He'll talk when he's invited to speak. And we'd be very fortunate to get him to come here at Cambridge and speak at great length. But listen to the interview he held recently. It's actually quite an important one.
Dean of the Yale School on Environment and Forestry, Gus Speth, says American-style consumer capitalism must change in order for us to save the environment. Next. Welcome to On Point. I'm Monica Trousy. Joining me today is Gus Speth, Dean of the Yale School on Environment and Forestry. Dean Speth is a former chair of the Council on Environmental Quality and founder of both the NRDC and the World Resources Institute. He is also author of the new book, The Bridge at the Edge of the World, Capitalism, the Environment, and Crossing from Crisis to Sustainability. Quite the resume. Thanks for coming on the show.
Thank you, Monica. I'm glad to be here. All my groups have done better after I left.
Oh, is that right? Yep. Your new book is very reflective of the work that you've done over the last several decades in environmentalism. And you say you're nearing the end of your career, and after decades of being a leading environmentalist, you're not happy with the results. Why did you decide to write this book?
Well, you have some time to reflect in the academic world, where I am now, and I realize that it's been almost four decades since a group of us first had the idea of starting the Natural Resources Defense Council, 40 years. And during that time, our environmental movement, if you will, the number of groups, the amount of money, we've grown larger and more sophisticated. But if you look at the results, after all that effort, we're on the verge of ruining the planet. And that's a very serious situation. And so what we're doing today in terms of the types of approaches we're taking to the environment, in the end, I don't think are going to succeed at the level we need success. So I wrote the book to try to explore different ways of approaching some of our environmental issues.
Why haven't environmentalists been more successful? There's been a lot of money put into this, a lot of time, a lot of effort. Why hasn't there been more success?
Well, I think there have been a lot of successes, and I shudder to think what the world would be like today or what our country would be like without them, without all of that effort. But still, if you look at the trends, the global trends, and even the trends on the more domestic issues here in the U.S., they're not reassuring. The climate issue is clearly on the cusp of getting beyond our ability to deal successfully with it. We're losing tropical forests at a rate of an acre a second and have been for decades. We have not been able to do anything about that. The toxic chemicals buildup continues in our society, and I could go down that long list of very disturbing trends and data points. We're losing 6,000 acres a day of open space in the United States now. So why hasn't it worked? Well, I think what's basically happened is that we are up against a mighty force which is pushing enormous amounts of economic growth forward at a very rapid rate with increasingly complicated technologies. And we just haven't been able to cope. And the gains that we've made have tended to be overrun by the expansion of economic activity.
Okay, there you have it. A 40-year veteran, founder of the NRDC, the Natural Resources Defense Council. He's a lawyer, founder of the World Resources Institute. Looking back on 40 years, we're not making enough headway against the overwhelming effort to grow. The growth economy is what's problematic here. Not only have there been some victories, there have been quite a few, and he's been at the forefront of the victories. And he shudders to think what would happen if he hadn't been there, or if others hadn't joined with him and, in fact, founded the environmental movement. But after 40 years, the success rate of stopping the destruction has not been very impressive. As he acknowledges, we need a new strategy, is what he's arguing. And that's very interesting to see him work out. He's actually been working on this for quite a while, and it's worth picking it up whenever you can find information.
Have economic growth and obsessive consumption become a substitute for dealing with real social and environmental concerns? Yes, says Gus Speth, Dean of the Yale School of Forestry and Environmental Studies. In his book, The Bridge at the Edge of the World, Capitalism, the Environment, and Crossing from Crisis to Sustainability, Speth says that in affluent countries like the United States, sustaining people and sustaining nature have been eclipsed by the relentless pursuit of economic growth.
In our country, I would argue that we've reached the point of uneconomic growth, that we're having a lot of economic expansion costing us more than it's benefiting us. If you could add up all the environmental losses and other problems that commitment to growth at all costs is causing, the loss of our communities, the ruthlessness of the economy, and multinational corporations have taken 2 million jobs out of the United States the first few years of this decade, for example. There's been huge social, environmental, and personal costs to this commitment to keep growing at all costs.
The dean notes that it took all of history to build the $7 trillion world economy of 1950. Today, economic activity grows by that amount every decade. He says that society is facing an enormous increase in environmental deterioration, just when we need to move in the opposite direction.
If we continue the toxification, if we continue the biotic impoverishment, if we continue to destroy the Earth's climate, we are going to, in this century, we will leave a ruined world to our grandchildren. And all we have to do to ruin this planet is keep doing exactly what we're doing today. We don't have to have any growth whatsoever. No population growth, no economic growth. We just keep doing exactly what we're doing today, emitting the same amounts of greenhouse gases that we do today, depleting environmental and ecological resources the same way we do, spewing out toxic chemicals the same way we do. Just keep doing it, and by the end of this century, the planet won't be fit to live in.
A former White House advisor and co-founder of the Natural Resources Defense Council, Speth says the emergence of climate change has people paying more attention to the environment.
Well, we had a real birth of environmentalism in the United States in the late 1960s and early 1970s. And most of the legislation that protects our environment today was passed back in that period. And then the bloom sort of went off the rose for a long time. And I think the environmental community grew stronger. There were more and more groups built up over those decades, and more and more initiatives were taken, but the public interest did wane and the press interest waned. But it's come back again now in a big way, particularly, I would say, in the last 2 years almost. And I think it's largely driven by the climate issue and the deep, profound concern that people now have about climate change and what that could do to the planet and what that could do to the future and their children and grandchildren.
Speth says that growing social inequality is linked to environmental decline. He calls for measures that provide for universal health care, guarantee well-paying jobs that are family-friendly, and give individuals more time to connect with their communities and nature. He calls on Americans to mobilize spiritual and political resources for change.
What I believe needs to happen is that we need a fusion of people who are concerned about environment, who are concerned about social justice, who are concerned about making our democracy work and restoring real popular control. We need these communities of shared fate, because we're all locked out, in a sense, together. We need those communities to come together and form an unusual and powerful political alliance in our country to, you know, reestablish popular values, citizens' values, into this machine that we call their economy.
Okay. Well, this is quite an impassioned appeal for citizen-scientist alliances on all fronts, from social justice through to healthcare through to climate action. It's really quite extraordinary to see this from people now emerging on all sides of the spectrum and willing, in this case, to be arrested for it and out in front of the White House. We've turned into a culture that criminalizes the best and the brightest, people like Gus Speth, people like Bill McKibben, people like Naomi Klein. Naomi Klein went off to jail in the same protest, and she's been coming through speaking about these issues as well. His book is worth reading in great detail, so pick it up over the Christmas break here and read its contents, focusing on the subtitle here, Capitalism, the Environment, and Crossing from Crisis to Sustainability. He's not one bemoaning the future. He's saying the challenges are there. In fact, this is what we've got to move beyond, criminalizing the best and the brightest, and bring out the best in ourselves, in some sense, as we look to the solutions by building new social coalitions. Keep in touch. We'll keep you in touch with these things as we go forward. Thanks very much. See you next week.